the sound, another perceives parcha, the touch, another perceives rupam, the form and color, another perceives rasa, the taste, and the fifth one perceives gandha, the smell. Thus we have five sense organs objectifying fivefold attributes, shabda, sparsha, rupa, rasa, gandha. In fact, the whole universe, physical universe, is nothing but a blend of shabda, sparsha, rupa, rasa, gandha. That's why it is called prapanchaha. Prapancha means what? The world consisting of five segments in the form of shabda, sparsha, rupa, rasa, gandha. And that is why you close the five sense organs, the whole five segmented world disappears. And now our Nirguna Krishna Ishvara doesn't have all the five attributes. Therefore he is called what? Avyaktam. That means what? The original Krishna cannot be seen. Original Krishna cannot be heard, smelled, tasted or touched. So what about this adharam madhuram, vadanam madhuram and all? So beautiful lipped Krishna. What about that Krishna? According to Krishna himself, they are all non-original Krishna. They are apara prakriti. They are maya manusha vesha. You start with maya vesha, but you have to transcend the maya vesha. And there are some people who meditate upon avyaktam. Okay. There are many things which cannot be perceived by the sense organs, but they can be conceived by the mind. There are so many emotions, love, anger, happiness, etc. They are not perceptible. Many mathematical, scientific concepts and laws you don't see, but they are all ideas. Ideas cannot be perceived by the sense organs, but they can be conceived by the mind. That's why they are called concepts. Okay, can you say Nirguna Krishna can be conceived by the mind? Krishna puts another bombshell, achintyam. I cannot be conceived nor be delivered. Conceive panna, delivery maayidam. Okay. So there are, priyar tho, take 2 minutes. So therefore, I am not one of the concepts of the mind. It is not a mathematical theorem or idea. Therefore, I am unobjectifiable by your mind also, achintyam. Inconceivable. In Sanskrit, mano agocharam. First one is what? Indriya agocharam. Ippa enna solrom? Mano agocharam. And if the Lord cannot be perceived or conceived, how can you talk about that Lord? Because words are sound symbols used to communicate the objects which are either perceived by you or conceived by you. So you see this, when this was invented for the first time, there is an object perceived, and therefore for transactional purposes you want to invent a word. So you invent the word clip. So the word clip came only as a sound symbol to communicate an object which is sensorily perceived or mentally conceived. When God is God means the Nirguna God is neither sensorily perceived nor mentally conceived. How can you have a word to talk about that? And therefore, the Lord cannot be described also. Therefore, anirdeshyam, indescribable. So, imperceptible, inconceivable, indescribable. So, namu fundamental la doubt vandudum. Appadi onnu irukkuma? Is there any possibility at all of the existence of such a thing? As somebody said, it appears to be a big bloated bladder of bluff. Na? So there are some philosophers who say that Nirguna Brahman doesn't exist at all. It is like the emperor's robe. So we go on talking, and the Paramananda Shishyas, out of respect for the teacher, they nod. They nod their head. It is not possible. That is what it appears. Because it is imperceptible, inconceivable, and indescribable. So we may think, in fact, all put together, in one word we can say, it is unobjectifiable. Because these are all different pramanams. Sense organs are called pratyaksha pramanam. Mental concepts are called anumana, arthapatti, etc. Words are called shabda pramanam. Sarva pramana agocharam. Unobjectifiable. One technical word we use for this is aprameyam. Therefore, Nirguna Ishvara is aprameyaha. That's why in Vishnu Sahasranama, one of the nama is aprameyo rishikeshahatan padmanabho maraprabhuhu. They say, adala somebody had confusion, it seems, padmanabho maraprabhuva amaraprabhuvan. So somebody said, both are correct. Because in Vishwarupa Darshanam, we have said everything is Lord. Therefore, Lord is Maram also. So Padmanabho Amaraprabhu, the Eternal One. Padmanabho Maraprabhu, the tree also. Anyway, that is a different aside. What I want to say is, Aprameyaha. Now, once we say that Lord is unobjectifiable at all, we will conclude such a God cannot exist. And therefore, Krishna puts another bombshell. He says, do you say Nirguna Ishvara is not there? I say, he is everywhere. Sarvatragam. Nirgunam Brahma not only exists, but he within quote, because nirgunatukku he, she, itellam solla mudiyadhu. But we have to use some pronoun. So Nirguna Krishna is everywhere. That's why when somebody wrote God is nowhere, what did he do? Put a comma after W, N-O, W-H-E-R-E-L-A, W kapparam kama pota, enache, nowhere becomes now here. And when you look around, Vedanta will say, tat tvam asi. That's secret. So, sarvatragam means all pervading. And if that Lord is all pervading, achalam. Can understand, achalam means what? That which does not move. A saguna Krishna, a personal Krishna can move from Mathura to Dwaraka. Dwaraka to battlefield, this place to that place, all are possible because Saguna Ishvara is finite, but Nirguna Ishvara being formless, whatever doesn't have form, is all-pervading. Because form always gives the periphery of an object. I have talked about this before, I think. Whether this hall is square or rectangular, how will you decide? You look at the periphery. Therefore, to have a form is to have a boundary. You can never talk about a form without talking about boundaries. Therefore, yatra yatra form, tatra tatra boundary. And if the Lord does not have the attribute of a form, that Lord cannot have a boundary. Therefore, akashavat sarvagataha, like the space, the Lord has to be all-pervading. And therefore, just as the space cannot move from one place to another, Nirguna Krishna also doesn't come and go. Then what about our Shodasha Upachara Puja, in which we invite the Lord, and not only invite the Lord and feed, at the end we say, Gaccha Yathasthanam Pratishthapayami. Therefore, the Lord that we worship is subject to arrival and departure, whereas the highest Lord is non-arriving, non-departing Ishvara. Therefore, Achalam. Thus, the word Sarvatragam and Achalam indicate Desha Paricheda Rehitaha, free from spatial limitation. As we saw in Taittiriya Upanishad, Anantam. And then the next word we will take up is Kutastham. Kutastham means Nirvikaram, free from all modification. We have seen 6 modifications on the part of the physical body. Do you remember? Asti, potentially existent, Jayate, born, Vardhate, grows, Viparinamate, metamorphoses, Apakshiyate, declines, Vinashyati, dies. These are the 6-fold modifications caused by what? Kala Tattvam, the time principle. So, anything that exists within time, anything that is influenced by the time, will go through what? All the 6-fold modifications. The higher Krishna, the Nirguna Krishna, is Kutasthaha, means free from all the 6 modifications, Nirvikaraha. In Sanskrit, Kala Paricheda Rehitaha, uninfluenced by time principle. And this word is beautiful. The word Kutasthaha has several meanings. One of the meanings is this. Kutaha means the anvil used by a goldsmith or an ironsmith, any smith. This anvil is used as a support. It steadily remains. And upon the anvil, the smith keeps the hot metal, and when it is hot, he strikes it and shapes the metal. And when he is shaping the metal, that red hot metal undergoes change, whereas the anvil underneath, it supports all the changes, but itself remains changeless. And suppose the anvil itself godagadan aadradhu vechungala. In some house that palahai they use for food or puja, adu marathile pandirukko illayo, in the weather change it will be like this. And then you sit, you will be moving. You cannot do any job. Therefore, if the metal should get shaped, the bottom one should remain changeless. A changeless substratum is required for all the changes to happen. Violent changes happening at the family level, at the physical level, body is getting shaped in different ways, going out of shape, sometimes coming in shape. And not only my body undergoes violent changes, the mind also undergoes so many changes. And if all these changes are happening, there must be a changeless principle which remains as the substratum, not only allowing all the changes to happen, but also witnessing all the changes. The witness of the changes should not be changing. Suppose I say that the morning class students are different from evening class, and evening class students are different from morning class. What do you know? That the students change, but the teacher is avasthatraya sakshi. If morning class student teacher is different and evening class teacher is different, I will never be able to say that the morning class students are different, evening class students are different. And therefore, the knower of changes should not be subject to change. And therefore, the witness consciousness principle is compared to kutaha, an anvil, upon which the body metal and the mind metal is hammered. Hammered by what? The various experiences of life. Every letter you receive, every phone call you get, they are all hammering on your head. When all these hammerings take place, your body changes, your mind changes, but there is the changeless one. And therefore, Nirguna Krishna is called the changeless substratum, which remains like an anvil. Kutavati tishtati iti kutastaha. That which remains changeless like an anvil. And since this Krishna is changeless, nirvikaraha, dhruvam. Dhruvam means eternal, kala atitaha. So thus, sarvatragam and achalam indicate desha atitaha, kutastham and dhruvam represent kala atitaha. These four words put together mean that Lord Krishna is deshakala avadhibhyam nirmuktam, nityamuktam, narayaniyam of Bhattadiri begins with this only. Sandranandavabodhatmakam anupamidam kala deshavadhibhyam nirmuktam. And the interesting aspect there is that all-pervading Lord is in Guruvayur. Appa nama eppadi purinjikanam? How do you understand to resolve the contradiction? How do you resolve the contradiction? By adding also. The all-pervading Guruvayur Appan is in Guruvayur also. கூட்டஸ்தம் அச்சலம் த்ருவம் சச் ஏ நிர்குணம் பிரம்மா. சம் பீப்புள் மெடிடேட் ஆஸ் ஏ பார்ட் ஆஃப் ஞான யோகா, ஆஸ் ஏ பார்ட் ஆஃப் ஸ்ரவண மனன நிதித்தியாசனம். அண்ட் நேச்சுரலி ஆஸ் வி ஹியர் திஸ் டிஸ்கிரிப்ஷன் வி வண்டர் ஹவு கேன் வி மெடிடேட் அப்பான் சச் ஃபீச்சர்லெஸ் பிரம்மன். அண்ட் தேர்ஃபோர் கிருஷ்ணா சேஸ் டு கம் டு திஸ் லெவல் ஆஃப் மெடிடேஷன் ஏ பர்சன் மஸ்ட் ஹாவ் ப்ரிப்பயர்டு குவாலிஃபைடு ஹிம்செல். So the next question is, what are those qualifications? Krishna mentions in the next verse, Sanniyamyendriyagramam Sarvatra samabuddhayah தே ப்ராப்னுவந்தி மாமேவ சர்வபூத ஹிதே ரதாஹ. தி ப்ரிப்பரேட்டரி குவாலிஃபிகேஷன்ஸ் ஃபார் திஸ் நிர்குண ஈஸ்வர தியானம் are presented in the Upanishads very clearly, and normally they are enumerated as the fourfold qualifications, sadhana, chatushtaya, sampattihi, which we have seen long before in Tattva Bodha. I am not going to the details, I will just enumerate them for my satisfaction. Discrimination, dispassion, discipline and desire. 4 D's. Okay. Don't say 3D thane kelpetirken solla. This is a different D. So therefore those who have not gone through Tattva Bodha or introduction to Vedanta should go through them necessarily, and those fourfold qualifications alone are presented in a brief manner in this particular verse. One qualification that Krishna emphasizes is Indriya Gramam Sanniyamya. One has to master the extrovert sense organ. One has to master the extrovert sense organs, which are all the time wandering. And if the sense organs are wandering out, it doesn't matter, they carry the mind also along. And that's why when there is a balli, a lizard in the middle of the class, class out. Because the eye sees the lizard and the mind also goes behind it. And why should we master the extrovert sense organs? What is the reason? I will give you a clue here. Previously, Krishna has described his higher nature, Nirguna Ishvara, as unobjectifiable one. Unobjectifiable na puriyardo, not experienceable as an object. And if Nirguna Ishvara is not objectifiable and still such an Ishvara exists, that Lord can exist only in one way. There is only one thing in the creation other which is unobjectifiable. Can you guess what it is? There is only one thing which exists in an unobjectifiable manner. With your eyes, powerful eyes, You can see everything except one thing. What? The eyes cannot see themselves. It's a very, very peculiar situation. So the unobjectifiable entity is the subject I alone. The unobservable principle is the observer alone. The unexperienceable principle is the experiencer alone. And therefore, the higher Krishna is non-different from me, the observing consciousness. So therefore, Nirguna Dhyanam is Atma Dhyanam. Meditating upon Nirguna Ishvara is meditating upon myself. Myself, not the body. Because body is objectifiable. We are talking about the unobjectifiable thing. And therefore, Nirguna Dhyanam is equal to Atma Dhyanam, or as Dayananda Swamiji beautifully says, meditation upon the meditator. Meditator meditation. Anyway, I am not going to the details. When some other occasion comes, we can dwell on that topic. And since I am not objectifying anything, my sense organs cannot afford to be extrovert. An extrovert sense organs will dwell upon objectifiable things, whereas I have to meditate upon what? I, the subject. And therefore, the sense organ should be non-extrovert. If you remember the 6th chapter of the Gita, we have talked about meditation, where Krishna said, you withdraw all the sense organs, and what should you do with the eyes? Do you remember? He said, Sampreksya Nasika Gram Swam. So let your eyes be focused on the tip of your nose, not nose dhyanam. So the focus on the tip of the nose means let it not focus any external object. And therefore, Indriya Nigraha is one qualification required. Then the next qualification, Indriya Gramam. Gramaha means not village here. So, Indriya Gramam is not a village. It is not a village. Grama means Samuham, the group. Village is called Grama because it is a group of houses. Any group is gramam. So, Indriya Gramam means the group of 5 sense organs. And next qualification is Sarvatra Samabuddhayaha. So, maintaining equanimity under all circumstances. Samabuddhihi means an equanimous mind, a balanced mind, a poised mind, which means a mind which does not have strong ragadvesha. If there is a strong attachment, the mind will run after that object. If there is a strong hatred also, the mind will run after for cursing. So, whenever there is strong raga or dvesha, mind will not have balance. Such a mind cannot meditate, and therefore may you reduce the intensity of raga dvesha. Raga means attachment, dvesha means aversion, likes and dislikes. This is the second qualification. Then the third qualification mentioned here is Sarva Bhuta Hite Rata. being committed to the well-being of all the creatures, all the living being. Universal love, interest in the well-being of the entire universe. That means not a narrow mind, but an expanded mind. That's why our prayers are so beautiful. Sarve bhavantu sukhinaha. There the pronoun alone is used. Sarve manushyaha chalala. Sarve haindavaha Hindus chalala. Sarve Indians chalala. Sarve means what? All creatures.
Tachayoravrinimahe gatun yajnaya gatun yajnapataye daivi e swastirastunaha swastir manushebhyaha urdhvanji gatu bheshajam channo astu dvipade e shanchatushpade.
All two-legged creatures, four-legged creatures, six-legged creatures, eight-legged creatures, all of them. So therefore, I should sensitize the mind to feel the pains of other people. It requires a mind with empathy, a mind which can feel the difficulties of others and being interested in the well-being. Now the question is, how can I be interested in the well-being of all the creatures? I am not able to be take care of the well-being of my family. Adhiliye 1008 complaint. So if you interview the children and wife or husband, you will know. So where is the question of sarva bhuta hite ratatva? Very simple. You can be sarva bhuta hite rataha by a very simple thing. Daily at least chant one prayer, and the chanting of the prayer will produce some amount of punyam, and that punyam, I say, whatever be the amount of punyam, I am distributing to the whole cosmos. If I am able to chant one prayer for 1 minute and say that idhile irukkara punyam, I am gifting to all the living beings, wherever, whatever suffering is there, let there be some benefit. This prayer itself makes my mind sensitive. This is called daya, empathy, compassion. Without such a sensitive mind, one cannot come to Brahma Jnana. So it requires a highly refined mind. A narrow mind cannot appreciate Brahman. Therefore, sarva bhuta hite rataha means interested in the well-being of all the living beings. So this is the qualification for what? Jnana Yogaha or Nirguna Ishwara Dhyanam, which is supposed to be the highest level of bhakti. And those people